This is a production of Cornell University.
All right. Thank you, everybody, for coming. I know it's a beautiful day, so I appreciate you spending time in the dark room with me. So I'm going to present some data from my second year of field work and a little bit of lab work, and just a select bit. So before we can get into the data, I want to talk about cover crops for a minute. So we're part of the Sustainable Cropping System Lab, and the bulk of my research is about cover crops. So I feel like typically this is how most people think of cover crops, as a vast expanse of aesthetically pleasing plants that you're going to sow before or after your crop. And aside from providing excellent habitat for lab managers, there are a whole suite of really good reasons to grow cover crops. So this is an evaluation of ecosystem services provided by cover crops from Scampanzi, 2014. The black line is cover crops. Gray is a rotation system that does not include cover crops. The farther away from the central point, the greater that ecosystem service is expressed when you use cover crops. So we can see you have a very diverse range of things that cover crops can give you, from nitrogen to weed suppression, pest suppression, and mycorrhizae. Now, when farmers are surveyed about why they want to use cover crops, the three things that come up, this is the top three reasons that a farmer might want to grow cover crops: to improve soil health, to increase soil organic matter, and to reduce soil erosion. So soil health is a little bit beyond my expertise, and I know depending on who you talk to, the definition changes, but these latter two, organic matter and a reduction in erosion, absolutely correlated to cover crop biomass. So it's very important that when we're working with farmers and we're having them grow cover crops, we want a lot of biomass because that's going to express these ecosystem services. So cover crops, there's a positive correlation with weed suppression. The more biomass of your cover crops you get, fewer weeds. If you grow something like vetch or clover in your mixture, they're going to put out a lot of flowers to attract pollinators. Those nice thick root systems increase worm abundance, reduces phosphorus loading. The one downside is the more cover crop biomass that you have a reduction in soil moisture. So this is typically why, as you go to drier areas, cover crop utilization is a little bit less than over here. And maybe seed predation. We're going to get into that a little bit later. So I know everybody's sitting here thinking, oh my god, if cover crops give us all these amazing things, surely farmers everywhere are growing them, right? And this is what I thought, but I was wrong. So here's a map of the US. The cooler colors, this is percent of cropland with cover crops. The cooler color is, so blues and greens, less cover crop being grown, the warmer colors is more. So New York is actually up here, not here. 10% of New York farmers, only 10%, implement cover crops into their farming practices, which is weird. You'd think, if you have all these great services, why isn't everyone doing this? And there are a couple reasons. So this is a survey, a recent survey of farmers as to what is dissuading them from using cover crops. And I really just want to focus in on these top two lines, time and labor required, and establishing the cover crops. So a big problem is, if we think of cover crops like in the context of that first picture that I showed you, where we have that beautiful field, in order to establish that, typically you have to harvest your crop first. And if you're growing corn and you don't get to harvest until November and then it snows 2 weeks later, the window for establishing your cover crop is very reduced. But what if I told you there was a way that we could increase establishment and reduce the time required to do it so that everyone could grow cover crops, well, almost everybody. And there is indeed a way. And so this is interseeded cover crops, which is sort of the meat of my project. And this is the agroecological gift that keeps giving. So you plant early summer with the corn's young, and it grows throughout the seasons. And then the following spring, you have that really nice expression of the full mix. And so at each of these points, you should be able to capitalize on all those ecosystem services. So there are a couple methods that people use to do interseeding. I just want to go over a couple of them. This is aerial broadcasting red clover seeds into soybean. Now, there are some drawbacks with this. A lot of the seeds, it's possible they're not going to actually hit the ground. They might get caught up in some of the plant. You're very much at the mercy of the wind and the rain. So if you spread your cover crops by broadcasting and you don't get rain for a couple weeks, your establishment's going to be way low. So a potential better way to do this might be with something like this. So we're still interseeding here, and these hoses are just sort of dropping cover crops into those interrows of the corn. So this is a little better. You can ensure that the cover crops are actually getting to the ground, not getting muddled in the canopy. However, you still have this problem that if there's a big, strong wind, you're not going to have cover crops in nice straight rows. So there's one more technique that when I first started reading about it, I thought, you know, new, progressive, really exciting. But it's kind of old and progressive. So this is a picture of from 1964. It's a high boy interseeder. So what's happening here is that the soil is being opened up so the cover crops can be planted directly into the soil in between rows of corn or soybean. So the benefits of this is that you're increasing the contact of the seeds with the soil. They're a little more protected if you don't get rain. And as an example, I really like this chart. So we have days after planting your cover crop on the x-axis, seedling count per meter squared on the y-axis. And this was they were looking at cereal grains as cover crops. So what I want you to focus on, these triangles, these are cover crops that have been drill interseeded. These guys were just broadcast. And this middle one was broadcast and then disked. But really, they found a significant increase in your seedling count when you drill interseed. So this is really something that would be good for more farmers to implement. Another really exciting thing about drill interseeding is how well they suppress inter-row weeds. So this is from a paper out last year. And because we're just talking about corn today, just focus on the corn graphs. So the black bars, no cover crop. In the inter-rows, the white bar has cover crop. And there's a significant reduction in weed density, both between the rows and within the rows, which they considered about like 10 centimeters either side of the corn. Now, when you're interseeding, there are some considerations you have to take into account for yield. If you plant your if you drill interseed your cover crops too early, they can affect the establishment of your corn and affect subsequent yield. So now that we know everything there is to know about interseeded cover crops, we can talk about my actual project. So there are three broad topics I want to talk about. So first is the effects of corn planting density on interseeded cover crops, the biomass and corn yield, then the effects of cover crop biomass on weed seed predation, and seed preference of weed seed predators. So to address this first one, we set up three experiments last summer, or three replicates of the same experiment, I should say. One at Cornell, one down in Penn State, and one in Maryland at USDA Bark. And the experiment was set up in a randomized complete block design with four blocks at each site. We had four planting densities. These were our treatments. Zero corn plants per hectare, so that was our one control. And then a low, medium, and high plants per hectare, so 37, 74,000, and 111,000. These were all interseeded with cover crops. And I just want to say we had a fifth treatment, which was this medium planting density that had no cover crop interseeded into it. So the plot sizes were 12 by 14 meters. We applied nitrogen as poultry litter, 280 kilograms per hectare, assuming about 50% availability for the corn. And we used flexier corn seed. So the cover crop mix was mixed up by Dave Wilson in Pennsylvania. We had hairy vetch, cereal rye, red clover, and annual ryegrass. So the two legumes here, before everything was seeded, were mixed with an inoculum just to help them out. And to give everybody a sense of field operations and why I was skipping class at the end of last year's semester, fertilizer application in early May, mold borer and disking that the following day, and planting on that same day. We had two blind cultivation events. So this is essentially dragging a very large rake behind the tractor, which is set at a pressure that's enough to pull up the weeds that have emerged, but not quite enough to hurt the corn. So two of these, and then once the corn gets a little bigger, you have to switch methods, and we did inter-row cultivation. So this is just targeting in between the crop rows with the S-tine there. And then just a little more than a month after we planted the corn, we interseeded the cover crops. Now, biomass of the cover crops were sampled at two dates. This is approximately 50 and 100 days after we interseeded, just from two quadrats in each of those treatments that we talked about earlier. I really like this series of photos. This is about halfway in between these two sample dates. At zero plants per hectare, 37 plants per hectare, and 111. So that's our control, low and high planting density of the corn. And you can see this nice difference in the biomass of the cover crop and the amount of light that's getting down to the cover crop. So let's look at some results. Here we have all three of the sites, so New York, Maryland, Pennsylvania, corn planting density. And this is expressed in plants per meter squared, not in plants per hectare. And you can just think about this as no corn, media or low, medium, and high. And then the log of the cover crop biomass, grams per meter squared. So this is in that first sampling date, so 50 days after we interseeded. And we see this really nice relationship, where as you increase the corn density, the biomass of cover crop decreases. So significant in all three sites, very exciting. And this trend continued. This is the exact same axes. The only change here is that we're looking at the 110 day, so that's the second sampling date. And again, some very nice regression. So the takeaway here was cover crop biomass was greater in lower corn planting densities in all three sites at both sample dates. And this is pretty consistent with a few papers that have been written on the subject. So this is cool. So we can tell farmers, hey, if you plant at lower densities, you're going to get more cover crop biomass, and you're going to get all these ecosystem services, or you'll get more of ecosystem services. Now, the other thing we have to take into consideration here is yield. So it doesn't make sense to tell farmers to plant at low densities if the yield is no good. So this is a nonlinear model of corn density again on our x-axis and grain yield. This is 15.5% moisture grain yield expressed in grams per meter squared. The dashed line in each of the three sites, that's the asymptote, so sort of the maximum grain yield you'll get. And we can see we got a pretty good yield in our three treatments, low, medium, and high. Of course, there was no corn where we didn't plant any. So the takeaway from this is that there is a bit of a trade-off between cover crop biomass and corn yield. So yeah, you get the most biomass when you don't plant corn, but farmers need to plant the corn. So there's a trade-off, but I think based on these data, which I should repeat, this is 1 year, and this was a drought year, and this was using flexier corn seed. But in that context, I think there really is a potential to find the equilibrium between a little bit of a lower planting density to maximize cover crop biomass. And now I think we can actually talk about some bugs. So the effects of cover crop biomass on weed seed predation. The idea of sampling for weed seed predation was we were hoping that after we established this gradient of cover crop biomass to see if weed seed predation follows that gradient. Before we get too much into it, we actually have to talk about weed seed predators. And I just want to say, in every other field, so if we're talking ecology or entomology, these are just herbivores or granivores, but it's really just in the weed science circles that they're called weed seed predators, which makes them sound stronger and sexier, I guess. So this is sort of the poster child of weed seed predation research. This is Harpalus pennsylvanicus, which is the dingy ground beetle. They're native to this part of the country. They're very abundant. And this is one that I spotted in September feeding on ragweed seeds before seed rain. So seed predation has been really extensively researched for a few decades. And I don't mean to focus only on invertebrates. Birds and mice are very important seed predators as well, but I like talking about bugs. But typically what we find is it's highly variable. And a lot of studies that research seed predation look at sort of a binary choice. Is it a no-till or a tillage system? Do you use herbicides and pesticides, or is it organic? What are the edges like around the field? What kind of weed is it? So we can't make these broad statements that weed seed predation is the same for all plant species. So something like velvet leaf, which has very large, very hard seeds, typically are not as often consumed as something like foxtail. It also depends on the quality of that seed. So how old is it? How much water it's imbibed, and if it's been buried at all. And then again, in an attempt not to broadcast and stereotype all these seed predators, seed preference changes depending on what you are. And even in something like carabid beetles, two beetles may have very different preferences because they have different body sizes, they have different strength mouth parts. And then the time of the year can also influence things. But despite all this variability, there have been a couple studies that have shown that seed predation is actually doing something. So they're eating the weed seeds, and they're actually having an effect on weed emergence. So this first paper I think that was about a 4 to 7% reduction in velvet leaf emergence. And the second paper found a 38% reduction in lamb's quarter weed emergence over 2 years. And both of them could show it was related to these weed seed predators. So how did we sample? This is standard operating procedure. These are seed arenas. So it's a petri dish flipped upside down with a piece of sandpaper attached to the top. Very lightly spray it with some adhesive and then sprinkle seeds on. And then you press that down into the soil and make sure it's flush with the soil level. Insects like beetles are not particularly intelligent, and if there's a bit of a lip on that arena, they'll just bump into it and then go away. So you have to be very, very careful with making sure that's at seed level or soil level. And so from my experiment, we just used giant foxtail seeds. And I sampled seed predation at 4 different dates after interseeding the cover crop in all 3 sites. And the way I analyzed this was with GLM. This was a quasi-binomial, so it's zero inflated and a lot of over-dispersion, which is why we have the quasi. And binomial defining a seed being eaten as a success and a seed not being eaten as failure. And then we compared means with LSD. So, we had 2 main hypotheses here illustrated by this graph. In general, what we expected to see was that as cover crop biomass increased, we would see an increase in weed seed predation by vertebrates and invertebrates. So I should go back a slide because I forgot to explain. So you can see one of these has a cage on top. That's to keep out anything with a spine. So seeds from this arena, we can say, are invertebrate only. And seeds that were eaten on this one, we can say, are vertebrates and invertebrates. So we expected predation to increase as cover crop biomass increased. And we expected to see more predation on open seed arenas than ones with cages on them. And what did we see? So here's an example of a caged arena. So the proportion of seeds consumed on the y-axis and the log transformed cover crop biomass from August, gram per meter squared, on the x-axis. And we, in fact, saw a positive relationship, which was great, really exciting. And this was what we wanted to see. And in looking over at open arenas, we saw the same thing. So this is New York in our first sampling date, proportion of seeds consumed, increase in cover crop biomass. And I would like to say that we found this in everything, but that would be an alternative fact. And in fact, there was a lot of nothing. So each of these, so these are states, caged arenas, open. I ran 8 models for each of those. So the total, the hope was that we would find 8 positive relationships in each of those. Turns out the vast majority were not significant. This was kind of a bummer. But what about just looking at open versus closed? Sorry, this is very busy. New York, Pennsylvania, Maryland. And here we're looking at open arenas in gray, caged arenas in white. And the 3 treatments that we're looking at are the control. So this top refers to the corn density, and the bottom refers to if there was cover crop. So that's no corn with cover crop, the medium density corn with cover crop, the medium density corn without cover crop. And so we found that seed predation on the arenas that had a cage was less than the arenas that were open. And because there's so much data, and I felt kind of sad, I wanted to look for broader patterns. And did another model. This was a mixed effects GLM, again, seed predation as a function of site and date. The random effect was block and treatment. And we used Bonferroni to check for differences. So here we have our sample dates, August, September, October, November, and the proportion of seeds consumed. These are closed arenas, so the ones with cages. The letters show significant difference, but only in that date. We're not comparing across dates. We're comparing between sites at each date. So we have Maryland, New York, and Pennsylvania is blue. So we see that at least in New York and Pennsylvania, it changed over time. And the one bit I really was interested to see was it's more pronounced in New York, but a little bit in Pennsylvania here, where there's a bit of an uptick in seed predation. And this has been noted before. Westerman et al. Found that when you grow crops that are phenologically late and provide cover late into the fall, you'll typically see the same pattern of an uptick in seed predation. Now, on the open arenas, it's a little less exciting. It varies slightly over time, and we did see some difference between sites. Pennsylvania, for three of those, had the greatest seed predation. So, what we can take away from the seed predation data is not much support for the effect of cover crop biomass on seed predation. We saw more on our open arenas, and it changes a little bit over time. And so now I just want to talk a little bit about a fun lab experiment that we did over the course of last summer. So the reason that we know that seed predators are weed seed predators is because people have done a lot of lab tests to see what they like to eat. So for example, this is the results of preference using that bug that was on the slide before, Harpalus pennsylvanicus, in no choice and choice trials. So what this means, no choice, is that you lock the bug up in a container and you only give it one kind of seed. And you see if it eats that seed. And then you can say how much of that seed it ate. And then you can rank them. This graph below is the results of a choice trial. So we're using all the same seeds, but putting all the seeds into the container at the same time, and then seeing if the preference changes of these insects. Now, because I think a lot about cover crops and seed predation, when I read a paper like this, it got me thinking about cover crops. So if we know that cover crops are very often broadcast, are they eaten by these weed seed predators? And it seemed very silly to me that a beetle would look at a ragweed seed and say, hey, that's a weed, and look at a clover seed and say, the people like that one, I'm going to eat the ragweed seed. It seemed kind of silly. And as it turns out, no one had really investigated invertebrate seed preference of these cover crop seeds. So this was something that I wanted to do. Now, if anyone was hanging around at Leland last summer, probably saw me wandering around with a net and some cups. Basically, I set some dry pitfall traps, about 80 of them, up in Caldwell Field, checked them every day, would usually bring in a nice haul of bugs. These would have to be separated out by species, and then they were stored for 4 days in what are affectionately called starvation chambers. So this is a deli container that has a moist paper towel in the bottom, and I've had 10 bugs of the same kind in each of these, and then put in cold storage, so 4 to 7 degrees Celsius, just the fridge up at Leland. And you do this to standardize how hungry they are and to do it in such a way that they don't end up eating each other. This is why you need the cold temperature. Now, after they came out of the fridge, they were hungry, then I did some tests on some seeds. So in no particular order, these are the seeds that I tested preference on. So these three that are outlined in green, velvet leaf, common ragweed, giant foxtail, these are three weed seeds. And there's some literature on a few bugs that they like to eat. There's data that shows they like to eat these. So those are reference seeds. Everything else is a cover crop. And what we tried to do was have a mixture that provided different sizes. So the difference between cereal rye and something like red clover. Here's a scale, each of these. That's a 9 centimeter measurement. So we had size, we had a mix of grasses, dicots, and there were some legumes thrown in there. So it gave us a lot to work with to really try to see if there were trends in what they like to eat. So after they had been cooled off in the fridge, they were tested in no-choice trials and choice trials. So again, to reiterate, in these no-choice trials, they were locked up in a petri dish with 26 seeds of just one seed species. And then the choice trials, it was 2 seeds each of 13 species. And we kept them in there for 5 days, and at the end counted the seeds to see what they liked to eat. So the analysis, there's a lot going on here. We had to analyze choice and no choice differently. So no choice, it was the same as we saw before with a random effect GLM, where our fixed effect was seed species, random effect was collection date, and we used Bonferroni. So choice, we used this electivity index. So this was developed in the 70s, and Christine introduced me to this, and it's really wonderful. So basically, what we're looking at, WI, is calculated as the number of seeds of one species that was eaten over the number of all the seeds that were given divided by the sum of that across all of our treatments, or all of our trials. N refers to the number of food species we provided, so that was 13. And EI ends up giving you a calculation of between positive and negative 1. So negative 1 means they hate the food and they don't want to touch it. Positive 1 means they really like it. And then everywhere in between you can get a value for, and then rank that EI again with Bonferroni. So let's look at some results. So these are two of the bugs we looked at. This is Allanimobius alardi, which are the very tiny crickets you find up in the field. And this is Harpalus pennsylvanicus. So N equals 11 for this guy. That means 11 trials each of these seed species. And for Harpalus, it was 20. So that was a total of 260 Harpalus that we monitored. And we see some interesting results. So things in gray are our cover crops. In white, those are the weeds. Now, this was pretty reassuring because it looked like that in both of these cases, the most preferred seed was a weed seed. Hooray. But they also readily consumed cover crop seeds. And we also see here hairy vetch, velvet leaf, very hard seeds, very large seeds. These guys don't have the equipment to deal with that, so they didn't really eat them. And we can pick out some trends. So with Harpalus here, typically you liked smaller seeds and grass seeds. So foxtail, annual rye, pearl millet, all pretty small grasses. And clover over here is small. And we had two other species we looked at. And I'll just say, so for the cricket you saw on the previous page, and for this beetle, there have never been seed preference trials that I could find in the literature. This was Gryllus pennsylvanicus, which is a larger cricket. So that was only six for each of these. And the reason it was only six is these guys are really hard to catch. You have to catch them under a log. And it takes time to learn how to catch them by hand, applying enough pressure to not squish them. Beetles are a little easier because they're so hard. So up here, we see a pretty broad preference. Because it's a bigger bug, they were able to eat the bigger seeds. Pterosticus, this guy, really liked cover crop seeds, especially pearl millet here. So this is really interesting. I'm going to put everybody up at the same time. So this is the choice experiments. So our 13 seed species and the electivity index on the y-axis. So remember, negative 1, they don't like it. Positive 1 means they love it. And positive numbers, the more positive that the electivity index is, the more they like that seed. So I don't know if you remember from two slides ago, but this cricket, this was its most preferred seed in the choice experiment. So this is one reason why it's really important to do both a choice and a no-choice experiment. So for, you know, if someone locked me up in a closet for a couple days and then gave me moldy peaches, I would eat them. It's not going to be my most preferred food, but I'd eat them. So if you give me a choice, I'm probably not going to eat them. So it's important that we do both of these, and then we can look at if the choice changes. If anything, these results are a little more unfortunate. The most preferred seed there, cover crop, cover crop, cover crop. This guy still likes giant foxtail, which is nice, thank you, but still feeds on cover crop. So they all readily eat them, and this is bad. So until now, these bugs have been touted as an ecosystem service and as beneficial insects. I would argue that based on these lab results, and again, it's just one summer, that if you're broadcasting your cover crop seeds, they're not beneficial. So you might get hit with a double whammy. If they prefer cover crop seeds, they're going to be reducing the number of cover crop seeds you have in your field. And they're going to be taking predation pressure off of the weed seeds. So they're doing two things you don't want them to do. So I think really this hammers home the importance of how we interseed our cover crops. And that when you do drill interseeding, again, we looked at you get more seedlings that grow. Establishment is better. And now you can still get your ecosystem services and still keep those bugs as your friends if we bury the seeds. So there's a lot of research that shows when seeds are buried, they typically don't eat them. So this is my pitch on why people should start really adopting drill interseeded cover crops. So I'd like to thank Matt and my advisors, or my committee members, and all the wonderful people at the Ryan Lab who helped out. And I couldn't have done any of this without them. The folks in Beltsville and Penn State, Cornell Statistical Consulting Unit, and the insect collection. And just in general, I'd like to say, you know, thank you to everybody here, not just for coming, but it's been really wonderful to be part of Cornell. And you all set a very, very high, hard to reach bar on what is considered good research. And I haven't always kept up, but thank you for being there and providing that. And questions?
So I think we do have time for questions, so why don't you take them as they come?
So maybe you said it in a sort of like, did you always give them
Yeah, so I have that data. I haven't really figured out how to. So in terms of looking at, we had those 26 seeds, 13 species in a petri dish, and sort of boiling down to what you count as preference if it's the first seed they eat versus the seed they eat the most. And the experimental design doesn't really lend itself so much to saying defining preference off of what they eat the most, or what they eat first, because there were only two seeds of each species. And we didn't have cameras, so we couldn't really tell what exactly they were eating first. Yeah.
So you did this in a single year. I'm wondering which retrospective you care to experiment
on. I would expect similar results. And for those four species, I would expect similar results in areas close by, because preference is typically dictated by how strong their mouth parts are.
Not just in preference, but in terms of abundance of meat predators.
Oh, you mean for the field stuff?
Yeah.
Oh. I don't know.
What about your results from scouting?
Okay, so the results from the first year of data, which wasn't presented, they were pretty similar. Not much going on. Tony.
Connor, would you expect a difference if the wheat seeds or the other seeds had been imbibed? I mean, they're not always going to be hard seeded.
That's true.
I know it was dry, yep. Obviously last year.
So it was a dry year, so we could argue that we were mimicking the drought conditions. There was a paper that came out 2011 that looked at seed preference when the seeds were dry versus when they were imbibed. And what they found was that overall you'd get lower seed predation, but the preference trends would stay pretty much the same. So when they're wet, yeah, they might eat a lot more giant foxtail, but giant foxtail would still be the most preferred seed.
Do you have any information about sort of weed pressure, I'm looking at, what's the sort of cumulative impact in the field studies of cover crop density versus, you might have changes in weed seed predation, you're going to end up with different numbers of weeds with different.
Yeah.
I'm just wondering if you have any.
Not yet. So I did like sample weed biomass when we did all the cover crop biomass. Trying to look at that as more of a path analysis sort of thing, because there are so many factors that can affect the bugs that are there, and then the interplay between weeds and cover crops. But no, not yet. Yes?
I'm curious, in that last experiment, how you dealt with the ratio of insects to seeds to deal with the fact that the same size meal takes more small seeds.
That's true. But typically when you look at these lab experiments, and certainly pictures I can show you, when seed predation happens, it's not that they finish eating a small seed before they move on to the next one. So typically they'll just focus on sort of the embryo area of a seed, and then they'll move on to something else. So we counted a seed consumed if the seed coat had been broken and if that part of the seed had been eaten a little bit. So not necessarily looking at the entire seed had been eaten.
So were they generally eating most of the seeds in there so that they're were they filling up?
It depends on the species, that it depends on the seed. I would say overall you didn't necessarily see more small seeds being consumed rather than big seeds.
So how did you decide?
This was a parameter established by someone who had done these feeding trials with Gryllus pennsylvanicus, and you count it as consumed when the seed coat is broken and when the embryo has been eaten. So basically it's sort of not germinatable. Yeah.
So I'm just wondering whether the weeds predator can pet you or eat the corn thing?
The corn? Little bit, maybe. But those are big, big, hard seeds. And because these bugs are adapted to just living on the soil surface and eating whatever is there, these ones at least, unless the corn had been harvested and there were a couple stray ears on the ground, I don't think you'd see them eating anything. Yes?
I was wondering, so at the very beginning of the spider graph, it didn't look like the non-cover crop and the cover crop were that much different with respect to weeds and brush.
It was a little bit more. And that's certainly one of the challenges with cover crops. But really, in organic agriculture, which is where cover crops are being sold, is very useful. It's sort of the management of that understory of the corn that's important. So maybe the weed suppression or the weed density it's not a huge difference, but it's still better than having only weeds growing under your corn.
Kind of gets the question of how many weeds do you need, how much do you need to control?
Right. Right. And for sure, you know, at the early stages of establishment with the cover crops, when they're this big in three little rows, they don't cover, they're not doing that much suppression. But so really, I guess it would also depend on the time of year that you're saying when it's suppressing.
One quick question on the corn variety that you use, the flex ear.
Yeah.
Could you explain why you use that one and what exactly it does?
So flex ear, if conditions are good, or if planting density is is lower, and there's enough energy, the corn can produce a second or a larger ear. And we used that this year because the year before we ran a similar experiment, and it was a drought year, and we got almost no yield. So we just wanted to make sure that should it be a drought again, we'd have a little more safety. Yes, Tim.
In the corn yield last year, it seemed that in Pennsylvania, the yields were rather low.
Yeah.
But the other thing I was curious about is that the density of corn, there seemed to be quite a lot of response to density, whereas in the other two locations, it tended to plateau more flat.
Yeah.
So could you have an explanation?
So if you look at the x-axis on that graph, Pennsylvania didn't actually achieve stands that were as dense as in New York and Maryland. So if you looked at it, I think the highest corn density they had was like 7.5 or so plants per meter squared. So it hadn't quite plateaued out.
So now you have a sense of what seed predators maybe go after which seeds.
Yeah.
And if we know something about what is around the margins of the field, could you imagine a system where maybe you could design it so that depending on whether you're going to do cover crops or not, or what cover crops, maybe you can pull in the right predators, the optimal predators, so that you have ones that eat the
correct weeds?
Yeah.
Maybe. I'd say what might be a little more my skills to be able to do would, based on preference trials like that, finding the least palatable seeds to the most number of seed predators, and then using that in your cover crop mixture. So if you know all these seeds don't get eaten, even if you broadcast, then the predation pressure should still be on the weeds, I'd hope. And that's 10 minutes. any more questions?
I think we're about out of time, so let's thank Colin.
This has been a production of Cornell University on the web at cornell.edu.